This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Remarks on the Management, or Rather, the Mismanagement of Woods, Plantations, and Hedgerow Timber. By J. West. Dedication. To John Evelyn Denison, Esq. M.P. Sir, having had the honor to spend 19 years in your service as resident land agent, having during that period as well as since received from you many marks of favor, having on your estate laid the foundation and to some extent tested the accuracy of the opinions which are given in the following pages, I am, I assure you, deeply grateful for the kind permission with which you have favored me to dedicate them to you. If I were to allow myself to indulge in the expression of feelings which a recollection of my long connection with your estates might prompt, I should risk your displeasure, for I well know how distasteful to you would be the language of adulation. I shall therefore only add that it gives me pleasure to dedicate my book to you, because, from long experience, I know you to be the zealous patron of improvement in every department of rural economy, and because you are practically and intimately acquainted with the subject on which I have written. Encouraging as it would be to me if it were so, I do not expect that you will concur with me in all the views to which I have given expression. Nevertheless, I trust I may be allowed to hope that in the main, the principles which are developed will approve themselves to your judgment and command your approbation. I have the honor to be, Sir, your most obedient obliged servant, J. West. North Callingham, Notts. The 13th of June, 1842. End of dedication. Preface. It has probably been with many others, as it is with the writer of this, who finds the little which he has to say by way of preface more disagreeable and more difficult than he has found any other part of his book. A preface, however, of some sort or other must be written. The writer cannot say, as some have done, that he has pushed off his bark and is content to leave it to its fate. He does not pretend, with Kent, the author of Hints to Gentlemen of Landed Property, that these hints are published from no motives of interest whatever. On the contrary, he is ready to avow that, while he would feel it, under a certain modification of circumstances, a most agreeable and congenial occupation of his time, to be employed in establishing a better practice in the management of woods, plantations, and sea, he is not in a position to be so disinterested as altogether to lose sight of his own interest in the matter. Further, while he feels it to be an object of vast importance to the great body of landed proprietors and others that a new system should be laid down and acted upon, the author wishes not to disguise the fact that he seeks the honorable distinction of being permitted to assist in correcting the evils which he thinks he may have been the first so strongly to point out. The author cannot but hope that he has proved all that can be fairly considered as implied in his title, and if he have done so, it may be productive of much advantage to those who possess property in woods, in sea. Their attention being once strongly called to the subject, they cannot fail to perceive that there is plenty for them to do. The author needs not to be told, for of that he is quite conscious, that his book is very defective in arrangement and faulty in style, but if he have succeeded in the attempt to be tolerably plain and perspicuous, and not very ungrammatical, that is as much, perhaps, as ought to be required of a practical man. One word is necessary here, with reference to Sir H. Stewart, whose name as a planter the author has mentioned. He wishes to correct an impression which he may have produced, that the Honorable Baronet is altogether opposed to the practice of preparing the soil previous to planting. This is not the case, but Sir Henry, with singular inconsistency, after speaking in the highest terms in favor of trenching, manuring, and sea, declares the practice to be inapplicable to plantations on a large scale. It is unnecessary to remark here that on this point the author is of a different opinion. P.S. The author reviews neglected woods, plantations, and sea, and gives directions for their proper management, or he would contract with any nobleman or gentleman to overlook their woods and sea at so much per acre per year. End of preface. Introduction. In writing the few plain remarks which follow, I shall, in a great measure, confine myself to the consideration of two main points, viz., the present state and the present mode of managing such old woods, plantations, and hedgerow timber, as I deem to be under a course of improper treatment, suggesting, as I go on, an improved system of management of them all. Respecting both these points, I shall have to make statements which, to me, appear very important, statements which I know cannot be controverted, and which, though they may apply, as they are intended to apply, more particularly to some districts than to others, will, more or less, apply to all where woods, plantations, and well-stocked hedgerows abound. Upon the second point in particular, I mean the present modes of managing property of this description, I shall endeavor to show in what respects, and as well as I am able, to what extent it is erroneous or defective. But first I would remark generally that although the treatment of plantations is bad enough, it is not so grossly bad as is that of ancient woods and hedgerow timber. I have for some time had it in my mind to write respecting the two latter, having been long convinced that a most extensive waste of property and loss of time was going on, but until now I have neither had leisure to prepare for, nor confidence to submit to a discerning public, those views which have been matured during an 18 years' observation and experience. I have now, however, resolved to print, and whatever may be the precise result to myself, if, by means of this publication, the attention of noblemen and gentlemen is drawn only to 100th part of their neglected woods and plantations, and of their abused hedgerows, so as to induce them immediately to determine to arrest the progress of the mischief that is going on, and not only to commence the work of improvement, but to proceed to the necessary extent in carrying it on, two most important results, at least, will be produced, viz., to proprietors themselves, a very considerable present or prospective advantage, in some cases both, and a large measure of real benefit to the laboring classes, in the increased demand which will be created for the labor of their hands. This last object is so vastly important that an enlightened and benevolent mind will always be ready to listen to any suggestions that may be thrown out to promote it. But at a period like the present, when one great constitutional change in our domestic policy has been made, and when there is too much cause to fear that another is about to be tried, each of which is as much an experiment in morals as anything else, it is invested with a much higher claim on the attention of those to whom the appeal may be made than in ordinary circumstances it would be. It will readily be seen that I refer to the new poor law and to the corn laws, the former of which throws the poor man almost exclusively on his own resources. To provide him, therefore, with healthful employment at such a time and under such circumstances will tend more than anything else can do to lessen the difficulty and danger of the transition from the old to the new law, and to mitigate the perhaps necessary severity of the provisions of the latter. Before I proceed any further, I would state that I shall not attempt anything like a systematic course, nor shall I confine myself to a scientific arrangement of my subjects, nor again shall I trouble myself about the technical names of the several trees which I may have to mention, nor lastly is it my intention to aim at elegance of composition. I do not write to establish a literary reputation, well knowing that to such an object I am unequal, and that if it were otherwise, there is a want of adaptation in my subject. But I wish to be understood as addressing myself to those who, not being themselves practically acquainted with the subjects here treated of, are not unwilling to listen to the opinions which I have formed, and profit by the experience which I have derived from close and extensive observation, while myself actually employed in the details of management, connected alike with the timber and coppice of ancient woods, with the planting and subsequent treatment of plantations, and with hedgerow timber. Of course, I am aware that much has been said, and much has been written, by others who have preceded me, on these subjects. But notwithstanding that this be true, I am not at all of opinion that this branch of rural economy has received its fair share of attention, or that the subject has been viewed in that particular aspect in which it is here presented, highly important and interesting, as that view must be acknowledged to be, when considered as it affects the growers of timber, the laboring poor, and the community at large. There will be many, doubtless, who will dissent from some of my opinions. They will have a good and sufficient cause to do so, if they adjudge them to be erroneous. They have just as much right to hold their opinions as I have to hold mine, but I wish it to be always remembered by those who may read the following pages, that every conclusion to which I have been brought, and every inference that I have drawn, has had its origin in actual experience. To practical men, and more particularly still, to such practical men as are like myself, to use a homely phrase, more at home in a wood or plantation than anywhere else, I need not make more than a general reference to what they daily see in proof of the mismanagement which I intend to show, but as to the proprietors it surely must be otherwise. They cannot, one would suppose, be at all aware of the fact that one part, and that a most interesting and valuable part of their property, is so mismanaged as to call loudly for an immediate remedy. I affirm, however, without hesitation, that while agriculture has made rapid strides in the march of improvement, and while that first of all improvements in agriculture, draining, although as yet but very imperfectly understood, and in a very serious number of cases very ill done, has been extensively attended to, while the adaptation of manures, although science has yet much to do, and much to teach us on this point, has been carried to such an extent as is unparalleled in any age, and almost in any country but our own, and withal so successfully, as to turn barren and hitherto sterile wastes, forests, and moors into productive occupations, while such an extraordinary degree of ingenuity has been applied to the invention and practical working of different implements, as to render the operations of husbandry comparatively simple and easy, and while yet once more the attention which has been paid to the breeding and rearing of the various kinds of stock has raised them to a pitch of excellence which our forefathers never contemplated, and which scarcely leaves any room for further effort. While all this proves, I say, that the large landed proprietors of this country, stimulated and assisted by the skill of the man of science, and by the enterprise and persevering efforts of the tenant farmer, have paid almost adequate attention to one part of their estates, it is equally undeniable that the present condition of a large proportion of the woods, hedgerows, and plantations furnishes proof of the grossest neglect and a perfectly unaccountable want of attention. To point out wherein this neglect consists, and to prove this want of attention, will be the object of the following remarks. It is really surprising that in an age like this, when there is an onward movement in almost everything else, such instances of mismanagement of woods and sea should everywhere meet the eye. If anyone well acquainted with the subject were to take horse and ride through every county of the kingdom, he would find in 90 cases out of 100, the old woods especially, to be in as bad a condition as if they were solely intended for fox or game covers, and incapable of being turned to any other use. They are permitted to continue precisely in the same uncultivated state in which their present possessors found them, gentlemen too often totally overlooking the important fact that while they might, by proper attention to the draining and improvement of their woods, and the best mode of disposing of the produce, give employment to a very considerable number of their poor dependents, increase the present revenue, and lay the foundation of a greatly improved permanent income from them, they would, to a very small extent, if at all, injure the covers for sporting purposes. As to plantations, the treatment may be said to be somewhat better, but as I have before said, in most cases it is bad enough, as I shall hereafter show. Of the hedgerows, I affirm that they are, very generally, either left entirely to themselves, or to the tender mercies of the occupiers of the soil, who, having no interest in their success, but rather the contrary, cannot, of course, be expected to exercise any care in their preservation. Having thus briefly introduced the various subjects which it is my intention to notice more fully under separate and distinct heads, I shall commence my first chapter with Ancient Woods. End of Introduction. Chapter 1, Ancient Woods. While
professionally, we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.